inflation. Dr. Nash emphasized a large part of the budgetary, fiscal, and regulatory aspects of big government and growing government in our society. But there's a complementary part to it, and it's one that has dominated much of the discussion over the last several years since the economic downturn of 2008 and 2009. And that is, what are the dangers from inflation? How did the crisis come about? What has been actual Federal Reserve policy? What was the connection between the boom that preceded the crash of 2008 and 2009 and Federal Reserve policy? And what has Federal Reserve policy been since then? Has it helped the recovery or has it hindered the recovery? And what is it that actually expansion of the money supply does, and how can that give us a better understanding of the nature of how our economic system works? And that's sort of the themes that I want to talk about in our time together this afternoon. First of all, how did we get into this economic situation? Well, effects always follow various causes. And the bottom line is that the economic crisis that occurred in 2008 and 2009 was itself the result of a preceding boom that was the result of Federal Reserve policy. As I say here, the current economic crisis through which the United States has been passing for the last 10 years is primarily, though not exclusively, the result of Federal Reserve monetary and banking policy. In 2002 and 2003, the then Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan and Federal Reserve Board Member Ben Bernanke were convinced that the American economy was faced with the danger of possible price deflation. That is, a period in which prices in general and on average might be falling one year after another. And they defined falling prices as a situation in which an economy would be going into a slump, a downturn, profits would be falling, unemployment would rise. I would just say as an aside that falling prices need not be an indication of economic bad times. Indeed, one can argue that in many instances, a situation of falling prices, a general price deflation, can be seen as an example of a healthy, prosperous, and growing economy. What do I mean by that? Tim pointed out that one example of innovation improvements in our lives over the last 30 years or so has been the transformation of the means by which we communicate. He pointed out that in that famous scene from Wall Street, Michael Douglas is holding this large, as Tim was saying, brick-size cell phone. And today we have these small items that fit into our pocket. And not only our telephones, but our email, our text messaging, our applications, our ability to go online, to watch movies, listen to the radio of our choice, and so on and so forth. Now, when these phones came on the market, as Tim was saying, they cost thousands of dollars. I remember just a handful of years ago, about 10 years ago, when they began to market large screen flat televisions. You could go into Best Buy and you could see them on display on the wall, and they were available for a reasonable and competitive price of $10,000 apiece. Now, I love television and I like watching TV and I like the idea of the big screen, but $10,000 was more than, in the language of the economist, I was either willing or able to pay. Now, just a few years after that, what had happened? There arose a growing competition in the marketing of alternative, improved, and better quality flat screen TVs in a regime of radically falling prices. Until now, one can go into virtually any of these types of Best Buy stores or their competitors, even into Walmart and so on. And one can purchase a good quality flat screen TV of various sizes and shapes for hundreds of dollars, or at most a couple of thousand dollars, to get a real high-end one. Indeed, that's not much different than the price range for now the 3D TVs that they have begun marketing. Now, how has this come about? It's the fact that the very nature of the market is over time to create a competitive incentive situation for if you're to capture market share and gain revenues and therefore earn profits, you, the entrepreneur, the enterpriser, the businessman, are guided by the requirement to constantly be marketing new, better, improved, and lower cost products for the purpose of which? To capture business that otherwise your rival is going to attempt to gain instead. That's the very nature of the market. That entrepreneurs and their creative ability are put at the service of the buying public. The consumers are king. The consumers have sovereignty. And all the producers, all the sellers, are our servants to fulfill our whims and desires and wishes. Now imagine a world in which one commodity after another, like the cell phones, the flat screen TVs, and so on and so forth, all are improving in quality and are expanding in quantities offered on the market and are being offered at lower prices to capture our business precisely because the competitive drive has been making entrepreneurs find ways to produce them for less so they can sell you those products for less and still, hopefully in that competitive process, earn a profit at their end. Have we ever experienced a period like this of dynamic, vibrant economic expansion, price deflation? Yes. And it was the period of the second half of the 19th century in the United States. The second half of the 19th century, that is from about 1865 when the Civil War ended to the beginning of the 20th century, 1900, was America's Industrial Revolution. Before the Civil War, we only had light industry, crafts, and agriculture. So our industrialization came in the 45 odd years following the Civil War. And what did it see? Well, there are economic indices and indicators, as best as economics historians have attempted to collect the raw data and collect the and construct the statistical averages. And what one sees is that between 1865 and 1900, the average level of consumer prices fell by 50%. And at the same time, money wages rose by another 50%. Now, was it an even fall in prices, an even rise in money wages? Of course not. Year by year, there's a little blips and turns and sideway moves, but looking over the trend of almost half a century. In other words, standards of living were rising by, in real buying terms, falling prices and higher money wages to buy goods at those lower prices by virtually 100%. And that was also a time with a growing population, both from natural births as well as a massive wave of immigration, as I was suggesting and mentioned in my talk this morning. That was the vibrancy, the creativity of capitalism. To raise standards of living with a growing population through industry, productivity, cost efficiencies to make more available of an improved quality of goods at falling prices. That's what economists often refer to as, quote, the good deflation. But Ben Bernanke and Alan Greenspan just defined any situation, as in fact the Federal Reserve still does, of any situation that suggests a period of falling prices in general as somehow an economic negative, rather than a period that can easily coincide with rising standards of living, economic prosperity, and improvements in the human condition. To counter any such danger, the Federal Reserve undertook a highly expansionary monetary policy to keep the economy on a path of rising prices. Between 2003 and 2008, two leading indicators of the supply of money, M2 and MZM, increased for this period respectively by 39% and 48%. And these are two charts showing this, which is just taken from a monthly publication called Monetary Trends, issued by the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis. With the banking system awash with all this extra money to lend, key real inflation-adjusted interest rates were in the negative range for much of this five-year period. And in the lower chart, you can see about in the middle of it is the zero point. And if you look from around almost the middle of or the last quarter of 2007 into 2008, they were in the negative range, as they were in the middle of that period from around early 2002 until 2005. Now, what does it mean, real rates of interest that are negative? It means that the Federal Reserve had pushed these key interest rates so low that when you adjusted for inflation, when a lender, when a borrower returned the money to the lender received a zero, a less than a zero return on the money he had lent to the borrower. To imagine this, imagine that I lend you $100 and you agree to pay me in simple interest a year from now $102, which would be a 2% rate of interest. Yet when you return the money to me 1 year from now, you pay me $98. That's what it means to have a negative rate of interest. You see what I'm saying? The real value of what you're buying gets you less when the money is returned than when you originally lent it to the borrower. The housing boom was fed by the extraordinary low lending rates resulting from Federal Reserve monetary policy. Those low rates of interest created a strong incentive for would-be home buyers to want to enter the market and lock in historically low costs of borrowing the money at which they would then be paying off their 15-year or 30-year mortgages, for instance. At the same time, that vast monetary expansion, as the previous slide showed, puts the banking system awash in so much cash that they had to find some way to make it available to people. And one was, given that the Federal Reserve was giving them this, all this money, what is one way to attract more customers if you have an increased or larger inventory of anything? You lower the price, you put things on sale. And that's what commercial banks did, awash in all of this Federal Reserve cash, lowered mortgage rates. And to attract people to take it, lowered their lending standards just to get it out the door. This was reinforced, exacerbated by another factor, separate from the Federal Reserve's policy by itself. And that is, it was intensified by the government's Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae guaranteeing loans offered below creditworthy standards to borrowers. Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, these government-sponsored and created lending institutions, one in the 1930s, the other in the 1960s, basically told the commercial banks, we want to lend people who are in the low, we want you to lend money to those in the lower income brackets. And even if they're not credit worthy, work history, credit history and paying back debts in the past, did they pay back their loans in a timely fashion, in full, etc. Even if they have a weak credit history by normal banking standards, lend them the money. Because every American, even the low-income people, have a right, an entitlement to be in their own home. And if you worry about whether you'll get your money back, don't worry. We guarantee them. If the loan goes bad, we, these federal-sponsored and created lending institutions, we will guarantee that you get your money back. Oh, you're nervous about even holding it in your portfolio because what if it's not paid back? Don't worry. Extend the loan. And then once you have lent that money to this below credit worthy borrower, sell us the mortgage. And we'll just give you the money to do it again. That is what was behind the financial crisis. Easy money to stimulate investment spending and borrowing, to stimulate consumer debt. Rates of interest are low in by normal standards for consumer debt, credit cards and so on, lines of credit. So just spend on borrowed money. And then exacerbated by this artificial housing boom that was fed by these federal institutions to stimulate home buying by uncreditworthy borrowers. The housing market collapsed when real inflation-adjusted interest rates rose into the positive range temporarily, as we saw in 2006 and 2007. It is a highly unstable stock market or housing market or investment market when rising prices in these markets are dependent upon interest rates that offer no or little real return for lenders, because they've either been artificially stimulated to do it by federal agencies or by the artificial creating of money by the central bank. The boom finally collapsed in 2008. But the practically immediate response of the Federal Reserve was to introduce a new expansionary monetary policy. In the five-year period, 2008 to 2014 or so, up to the last quarter, really till the end of 2013, the money supply measurements, again, M2 and MZM, have increased respectively by 33 and 30%. And we see that in the top chart. And again, key real inflation-adjusted interest rates have been in the negative range since the middle of 2009. Again, look at the lower chart, and you see they skyrocketed in the second half of 2008 from negative minus 3% approximately, probably about 3.5%, minus 3.5%, to above a positive 2%, and then precipitously falling again in the second half of 2009, and since then, been in the negative range, negative returns on money lent. 09 to the current time. This has prevented a normal and stabilizing recovery by creating distortions in the financial markets again, while seeming to create stability in the financial markets. And you can see the little cartoon there I put, former chairman Ben Bernanke, turning the handle of the monetary printing press. You know, I've always found it interesting. If I had one of those printing presses in my basement, and I was grinding them out, and then spending the money that I created, I probably, if I was found out to be, I would be arrested as a counterfeiter. However, when Ben Bernanke or the Federal Reserve in general does this, it's called generating national prosperity. I never quite seem to see the distinction there. How much has this new monetary expansion gone? Well, by early April 2014, the Federal Reserve had increased the monetary base, the amount of cash and bank lending reserves, by well over three times the level that it had in 2008. That is, from a little over $1 trillion of this monetary base, cash and bank lending reserves, to now, as of the Federal Reserve's basically balance sheet report issued this past week, to $3.82 trillion. The Federal Reserve injected this huge quantity of money into the banking system by purchasing large sums of U.S. government securities and federal government agency, that is Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, and other mortgage-backed securities. Now, if you look at this chart here, you will see that historically, the vast amount of assets that the Federal Reserve has held in its own investment portfolio, and on the basis of which it has created money by buying them, was up until 2008, if you look to the left of that chart, long-term treasury purchases. That is, bonds that are 10 to 30 years in length. The federal government borrows money for 10 to 30 years. Notice the difference here. Since that time, the Federal Reserve's investment portfolio has been filled with lending to financial institutions, and the orange, now almost swamping everything, being these federal agency mortgage-backed securities. And when Tim and I did this presentation a little while ago, I had one cartoon there. The upper cartoon shows Santa standing before some building at Christmas time, and if you can't read it too well, the dad is saying to the little kid, "No, Virginia, that's just Ben Bernanke handing out free money." In the lower cartoon, because I'm trying to be more, you know, up to date now that Ben is gone and Janet Reno, what's her name for the best? I'm aging myself here. Janet Yellen is head of the Federal Reserve as of third week of January, I guess. We see here the old, the new, and the improved. There was Ben Bernanke on his broom handing out the money, and now she is doing the same. Now, how exactly does the Federal Reserve increase the money supply? And I thought it would be worthwhile, because this is one of the most confusing things in the world. First of all, it is often said, well, you know what causes inflation? The government runs budget deficits. Yes, yes, that's the cause of inflation. The answer correctly is, well, maybe yes and maybe no. In principle, the government running a budget deficit does not in itself need to or actually cause inflation in a society. You'll see here that I have here step A in the upper left. The U.S. Treasury issues a $10,000 security, one of its IOUs. And I say $10,000 because that's the minimum block amount at which anyone can lend money to the U.S. Treasury. You could, if you have blocks of $10,000 or more, to actually lend. They used to, you know, constantly be talking about, buying U.S. bonds as a carryover from the Second World War. When I was a little kid, there would even be commercials on television, and buy United States bonds for your future. And they would always say, and don't worry, it's backed by the full faith and credit of the United States government. Now, what does that mean? And in fact, what does it still mean? Because that's what's backing any government borrowing today. The full faith of credit of the United States government. It means that don't worry about the government being like a private borrower. A private borrower might not pay it back. Why, if he invested it, the investment might turn out bad. He suffers a loss rather than a profit, and the loan might go bad. Or the consumer might take out a loan for a house and he loses his job and he can't pay back the mortgage. The mortgage goes bad. But don't worry about the government. You lend the money to the government, and it's backed by the full faith and credit of that U.S. government. What does that mean? That they promise to tax the rest of the society up the kazoo to any amount to assure that you, the lender, get your money back. Because you see, the private borrower does not have the power that the government has to see that it has the money to pay back the lender. The private borrower, like for an investment, has to make a product that others are willing to buy, upon which he earns the revenue that enables him to pay back the loan. If the consumers don't buy the product, he doesn't have the revenue. If he doesn't have the revenue, he can't pay back the lender. But the U.S. government has a means that you and I don't. It has a gun. And if that seems extreme, when next week comes, don't submit your tax return. And if you owe money, don't send it in. See what happens at some point in the future. You will be visited eventually by a U.S. Marshal who will garnish your salary, seize your bank account, or confiscate your home or car for payment for back taxes. And if you attempt to resist, he will threaten you with physical force. He will threaten to do bad things to your body, up to including killing you. So that is what backs U.S. debt, the full faith and certainty that the U.S. government will, if necessary, seize, imprison, and kill any number of other Americans to make sure the lender gets his money back. Now, that's, in my view, just like the Wizard of Oz, pulling back the curtain and looking at the guy behind the screen. Oh, no, don't look at them. Ignore the man behind it. Well, that's him. He's the one with the gun. But we don't like to talk about that. Not nice in polite society. Anyway, so the Treasury issues a $10,000 security because it wants to borrow money to spend more than the federal government is taking in taxes. Someone lends the Treasury $10,000, okay? Now, at this point, there is no inflation. That's like you coming to me and saying, "Will I lend you $10 for a week?" And if I do, then all this means that a given sum of money has been transferred from my use to your use for the period of the loan. When you retransfer that sum, and may or may not with any interest, that we have agreed that you're going to pay me. But the total amount of dollars in the economy has not been changed. Merely who holds the dollars and has use of it for a period of time has been redistributed under our voluntary lending agreement. And in principle, at this point, all that the government would be doing is having others forgo private investment uses or consumer uses for a sum of money that they will have available to them over the period of loan over which the private individual does not. Now, it might be good or bad for the government to finance its activities through such borrowing. Dr. Nash talked a little bit about this in his presentation earlier. A strong case can be made that deficit spending creates perverse incentives on the part of both taxpayers and those interacting with the government to hide the cost of the real cost of what government is doing. Because it makes the illusion that you can have something for nothing, because the government gives you a benefit today with no immediate tax cost to make it clear what the burden really is upon you to receive that supposed government benefit. But it remains a fact that in itself it is not inflationary. So how does the inflationary element enter the picture? Now let's look at step two. The Federal Reserve goes into what's sometimes called the secondary market. That's basically the private sector where individuals or financial institutions hold in their portfolios government securities on the basis of loans that they have extended to the U.S. Treasury, the federal government, at some point in the past, yesterday or years ago. And the Federal Reserve says, "Have I got a deal for you? If you will sell us some of that treasury security that you're holding, we will give you your money back right now, plus most or all of the interest that you would have been collecting from extending that loan to the treasury if you waited until the loan came to full maturity. Now, all other things equal, wouldn't you rather have your money back now with pretty much the interest you're going to earn anyway, rather than having to wait to get your money back with that interest?" And of course, most people would say yes. "Sure, but then I have my money back to do other things with now rather than waiting for the loan to mature." And that's why I put the $10,000 plus there, because the Federal Reserve will pay someone a little bit extra above the face value precisely to act as the inducement to sell those securities to them. And the Federal Reserve buys them, okay? Now, what does it mean that the Federal Reserve buys them? Well, they issue a check, right? Just like I might issue you a check for having sold me something. Okay, now that gets to step C. Someone deposits the Federal Reserve check for that $10,000 plus into his bank account. And of course, the bank now credits that person in their checking account up to that $10,000 plus, against which the depositor can write checks or make cash withdrawals and so on out of an ATM machine or use his debit card. But what is the bank, and that's like you depositing your paycheck, right? So now, but what does the bank do with that check? It says issued by the Federal Reserve to Joe Smith, and Joe Smith is one of our depositors and we've credited him the amount, but where's the money that this check represents? Well, virtually every bank in the United States is legally required to be a member of the Federal Reserve System, our central banking system, managed by out of its headquarters in Washington, D.C. And as part of this, every commercial bank in the United States that is a member of the Federal Reserve has a checking account with the Federal Reserve, just as you have a checking account. Literally and partly metaphorically, every commercial bank has a checking account with the Federal Reserve. In other words, the Federal Reserve is like the banker's bank. So the bank goes to the Federal Reserve and says, look here, this is your check issued to Joe Smith. We've credited his account, but we need to have that cash to meet any liabilities of spending that he makes out of it. Make good on the check. Now, what does that mean to make good on the check in this situation? It means that the Federal Reserve looks at, yeah, that's our check. That's our check. And now the Federal Reserve credits that bank's account with it for the sum of money that the check represented that they issued to Joe Smith when Joe sold the Federal Reserve that government treasury security. Now, where does the money come from for the Federal Reserve to credit the account of Joe's bank? With the click of the mouse on a computer screen. Is there a lot of paper cash that's still used in the United States? There's actually more cash dollars circulating in the rest of the world than within the United States. And we still use cash. But most of the transactions in the United States are not undertaken with actual cash money. It's done with checks, debit cards, credit cards, various types of account transfers, automatic deposits of salaries, all on the computer ledger books. So does the Federal Reserve actually still print money? Yeah, of course. Those dollar bills wear out. They need to be replaced. Some disappear. But the vast majority of it is all computer-created money. And that's why I say all they do is the click of the mouse. And out of literally thin air, that $10,000 plus have been created out of nothing. It's not even paper money. It's ethereal money. It's like spirit money that now is in the banking system, upon which step D, bank lends, Federal Reserve created new money to borrowers. That's the extra money, the reserves available in the banking system for the banks now to have the ability to extend more loans to whom? For consumer loans, most especially still investment business loans for business startups, business expansion, research and development. So borrowers can invest in new, better, and additional plant, equipment, machinery, tools, capital investment. And that's how the money then percolates out into the market economy. From the Fed creating it and buying a U.S. Treasury, to that person depositing the check, the bank having it made good by the Federal Reserve with the click of the mouse, and then the bank having all this extra money to lend. And again, having all this extra money to lend, how do you attract more customers? In this case, borrowers of one type or another. Tell you what I'm going to do. You borrow, you come in to borrow for the first time, or you want to borrow more, I'll offer it to you at a better price, a lower rate of interest. Because ultimately, in the market, the rate of interest is the price of borrowing a sum of money over a period of time. Now, I have to confess that many economists, and I'll admit it, even myself, expected that this expansion of the money supply would bring about a large rise in prices. I mean, extra trillions of dollars in the banking system. And then once this money starts percolating out in the economy, first into the hands of the borrower, and then the borrower spends it, and then the person who's received it for having sold something to the borrower, and then the next person, money should be percolating being spent, and prices should be rising. And it hasn't happened. In fact, price inflation, the general and average rise in prices in the economy, has been running well below 2% a year for most of the time since 2010. Well, why? Because the Federal Reserve started doing something that it hadn't been doing before. It was a new institutional policy, well, I was going to say trick, but I'll say tool to be seemingly dispassionate here. And that is, they wanted to put the money into the banks to enhance its capital position, given the danger of bad loans and having to write off the loans on the bank's own, you know, balance sheet. So they didn't want all the money to go out and being lent, because then how are they enhancing their capital position to shore themselves out up for the damage of bad loans during as the recession is hitting? And at the same time, they're already concerned, well, my gosh, if all that money goes out, you know, we're trying to fight the recession, it's going to cause price inflation. So what Ben Bernanke did as the chairman, and of course the other board members of the Federal Reserve, they began to do something unexpected. Most of the new money has been in the banking system as excess or idle reserves due to the Federal Reserve paying the banks a rate of interest above the market rate to not lend that money. Now, interest rates due to Fed policy have been relatively low, some close to zero or in real terms negative. So all the Federal Reserve has had to do is offer to the banks a little bit extra, a few percentage points above that, to make it attractive for those banks to leave that sum of money unlent in their own accounts with the Federal Reserve rather than to lend to you and me. And now you might say, but if you look at the actual, but you know, point like 1.5%, boy, that's kind of small. Why would they have that as opposed to lending to me? Because when you're talking about billions of dollars, 0.15% adds up to big bucks when you're talking about idly allowing billions of dollars to sit at the Federal Reserve and getting interest from the Federal Reserve as additional money that the Federal Reserve is creating for having done nothing. And in fairness, banks have also been trying to return to more market-based standards for lending money. Do you have a business plan? What is your credit history? Do you have a steady income? If it's a mortgage, are you closer to the historically normal cash amounts that we expect a homeowner to put down as a down payment, for instance? But it's basically the way the Federal Reserve has been paying banks not to lend the money that it itself created that has resulted, for the most part, in the lack of the price inflation that, other things held equal, this expansion of an additional practically $3 trillion of reserves in the banks should have been creating through that lending and spending process over the last few years. Now, one other thing when we talk about a price inflation is important to bring out, and that is the consumer price index versus the diversity of consumer choice. Now, as I say here, the consumer price index is meant to be a representative basket of goods regularly purchased by an average American urban household. The cost of purchasing this representative basket is tracked over time, with any change in its cost being taken to be a measure of changes in the cost of living. Now, if you follow the news, you know that the government distinguishes between two meanings or definitions within the consumer price index. They talk about all items and core, or that is, consumer prices minus energy and food prices, to determine what is price inflation, under the rationale that energy and food prices are more volatile and are presumed to give a distorted picture of actual price inflation and the cost of living. Now, beyond whether it's reasonable to subtract out food and gasoline, energy, because maybe I'm, you know, the outlier, but I usually eat more than once a day. And I've heard that a few other people around the world do too, which means that I have to buy food. And whether prices are trending in a direction steadily or are rising in one direction or another in a volatile, jagged way, I notice and have to deal with the actual prices of food in the marketplace. Now, prices do not rise evenly and at the same time. And so I also may be making micro choices. Well, the price of hamburger is rising more than the price of chicken, and while both are rising, hamburger is now more expensive than the chicken. Maybe I'll substitute between the two a little bit, but I still have to deal with the rising prices. So to say, well, we want to get at the real, you know, cost of living, so we're subtracting out food, I personally find a little bizarre. And energy? Well, you know, maybe I'm just one of those strange guys. I usually heat my house in the winter and air condition it in the summer, and I actually put gasoline in my car to drive around. But maybe that's just me. You know, I'm okay, you're okay, we're all different. So again, to presume that somehow energy prices can be subtracted out to get at a real core measure of price inflation is part of the reason why people say, well, the government says, you know, inflation is only, you know, this little X percent. It doesn't seem that way to me when I do my shopping or paying my energy bills, because you see, it's not. It's important to keep in mind that there is no average American household. It's a statistical creation. It's an average urban blue-collar family with a mom and a dad, or two moms and two dads. I have to be politically correct today. And 2.5 kids. That half is perpetually small. Okay, that's the thing. A married couple with 2.5 kids in an urban area. Okay. Now, the American household and family and one-parent households are radically diverse from this. Individuals and households differ in terms of the goods and services they buy and the relative amounts purchased in their own basket of goods. Let us suppose that I live in an area where I easily walk to do my shopping or even to walk to work. How much does gasoline price changes influence me? Minimally. If you look at the latest numbers and break them down, you find that, in fact, the number of meat prices over the last month actually rose by 8%, even though the overall average for the last month, according to the government, was only about 1.5%. Well, what if I'm a vegetarian? Does a change in the meat price affect me? No. On the other hand, if I'm not big on vegetables and fruit and vegetable prices change, that's not going to hit me. The whole point is that everybody has their own basket of both the goods in it and the relative amounts. And therefore, what's an average to tell anybody how inflation is impacting upon you? In the limit, you have to construct your own basket of goods. And the problem is the basket isn't constant. You change the relative amounts, you drop off goods that you're no longer interested in, you add other goods that before you hadn't included. So it's a situation where it's even difficult to know what your changing cost of living is, because you're not always comparing apples with apples, that is, the basket and what's in it and the relative amounts across time as we change and the availability of goods and the prices at which they're offered change. As a result, so how price inflation impacts people can vary significantly, given that prices do not change at the same time and by the same amount. Now, what has all this monetary expansion tended to create or generate or stimulate? I would suggest that what it has done is this easy money policy that the Federal Reserve has been carrying out as part of their fight the recession crisis policy since 2009, has been potentially to create another unsustainable stock market boom. As measured by the Dow Jones Industrial Average, stock prices have more than doubled between 2009 and 2013 and now into early 2014. From just over 7,000, just above 7,000 to over 16,000. How shaky a foundation it is was seen when Ben Bernanke suggested last June of 2013 that monetary expansion might be cut back. He didn't say it was going to stop. But they were thinking of what they called tapering. The market plunged and only rebounded when Ben Bernanke assured a continuation of the $85 billion a month Federal Reserve purchases of government securities and more and home mortgages for the foreseeable future. And the tapering off by the Fed under the new chair, Janet Yellen, to now a mere $65 billion a month. Oh, it's only $65 billion a month. Okay, if you insist, I'll take it off your hands, Janet. It's sending fears through the financial markets again that the easy money era and the time of near zero interest rates may be ending in the foreseeable future. And that, I suggest, the volatility in the stock markets right now. I'm not saying only. I mean, markets are influenced by a wide variety of variables. You know, crises in the Middle East, energy flows to Europe from Russia that might be threatened because of the crisis currently about Ukraine. All of these, you know, there's many variables that generate a particular market outcome. The world is not influenced at any one time by just one factor. There's no such thing as economic history. There is just history with all of its influence factors and interactive effects. But nonetheless, markets are becoming jittery that all of this money and some of this Federal Reserve created money has percolated into markets, not just the amount that some of us thought and feared when the process began several years ago, and that it has helped to feed the liquidity necessary to generate these stock market booms. And if it even slows down, will the money continue to be there to feed and sustain these dramatically rising stock prices in these different indexes? Now, why should we be concerned or fearful of inflation? Well, I've tried to enumerate some of the factors here. Arbitrary and unexpected increases in the supply of paper money by governments create a number of serious problems for the citizens of any society. Significant and continual increases in the money supply have a tendency to bring about a general rise in prices in the market. And as a result, the value of each unit of money in people's pockets decreases, since at higher prices, each unit of money now buys less goods and services on the market. The real value of savings as a consequence also decreases, since a unit of money saved today will have a lower buying power in the future when the saver wishes to use that saving for some purpose, such as supporting themselves in retirement. This can weaken, obviously, the incentive to save. Why bother saving when inflation is eating away at the real value of it, since everything is costing more as days go on? And the rate of interest is so low that the rate of interest isn't even keeping up with the rate of inflation. So I might as well just spend or borrow myself. What have I got to lose? And let tomorrow take care of itself. It increases the uncertainty about the likely cost and profitability of investments undertaken over time, making investment activity more risky and less attractive. The extreme cases of this occur during a hyperinflation. I've had the opportunity to visit Brazil several times. And one of them, actually my first trip there quite a number of years ago, was when Brazil was going through a hyperinflation. A hyperinflation is when prices are rising on average and in general by 50% or more per month. Per month, not year, per month. Brazilian businessmen, who were the supporters of the institute that had invited me down to give these talks, were telling me that because of the uncertainty, the volatility, the erraticness at which prices were rising so rapidly month by month, that they could not undertake investment planning horizons more than 3 to 6 months ahead. Well, you're all entering the world of business. You've been taking business courses. Isn't it usual to have a long-term business strategy and plan, to have a horizon for multi-year investment and production projects, and to be planning to incur some expenditures in the present that will bring you no money because you're expecting finally a payoff in the future that will have justified all the expenses and maybe some short-term losses? Of course, you have to take a long-run investment horizon. Inflation destroys the certainty of an already uncertain future. So much that the investment horizon collapses virtually to the present. You cannot operate a modern, complex, industrial society where businessmen cannot think ahead more than 3 to 6 months. That's the extreme volatility in investment decision making that hyperinflation can cause. It creates incentives for people to move their wealth out of uncertain productive activities and into investing in commodities or goods such as silver or gold or jewelry or works of art to try to preserve their wealth. Put it into something, as people sometimes like to say, real, that maintain its value over time, a Rembrandt painting, a bar of gold, a rare piece of jewelry. So lock it away in that form instead of being investing it in more and better equipment, research and development, expanding an industry, creating jobs. Again, it weakens both the investment and the capital formation processes in a society. And as I was saying a few minutes ago, during an inflation, all prices do not rise at the same time or to the same degree. This distorts the patterns of relative prices and can influence spending and investment decisions that will be found to have been misdirected and unsustainable when the inflation finally comes to an end. Let me suggest that this is the cause of what is the thing that we call the business cycle. The business cycle is an inflationary bubble, followed by an economic downturn and a recession or depression. And it is the result of increases in the money supply that distort interest rates and relative prices in the economy in such a way that many people invest capital into construction projects, industry, and manufacturing activities that seem profitable during the inflation, when the inflation continues, but which collapse like a house of cards when the inflation is slowing down or stopped. This aspect of the dangers of inflation, not its effect on the general or average movement of prices, but the fact that prices change unevenly at the different times to different degrees, and that it therefore threatens to influence the structure of relative prices, relative wages, relative profitabilities, and therefore the allocation of resources at the micro level among different sectors and investment projects during the macro inflation. That is the essence of its most unsustainable and distortive influences and effects. To quote Friedrich Hayek, leading economist, author of The Road to Serfdom, The Constitution of Liberty, Law, Legislation is Liberty, also the recipient of the Nobel Prize in Economics in 1974, to a great extent because of his own work on monetary theory, banking, and the business cycle. And here in a lecture he gave back in 1970, he says, the influx of the additional money into the system always takes place at some particular points. There will always be some people who have more money to spend before the others. Who these people are will depend on the particular manner in which the increase in the money stream is being brought about. It may be spent in the first instance by government on public works or increased salaries, or it may be spent first by investors mobilizing cash balances for borrowing for that purpose. It might be spent in the first instance on securities or investment goods, on wages or on consumer goods. This process will take very different forms according to the initial source or sources of the additional money stream. But one thing all these different forms of the process will have in common, that the different prices will rise not at the same time, but in succession. And that so long as the process continues, some prices will always be ahead of others, and the whole structure of relative prices, therefore, will be very different from what the pure theorist describes as an equilibrium position. If I can make an analogy, think of a pond of water, and you take a pebble and you drop the pond into the center of the water. What happens? At the point where the pebble hits the surface, from that point on, a wave is sent out, and another wave, a rippling of waves, until finally the entire surface of the pond of water has been influenced by the impact of the pebble somewhere near, let's say, the center. In other words, it distorts the entire surface, but in a particular time sequence as the ripples emanate out from its epicenter. That is how inflation really affects an economy. It's very easy to say, and at some broad level is absolutely true, an increase in the money supply increases spending power, so people demand more goods and therefore prices in general rise. That is a true statement, all other things held given. But the microeconomic process of this is that money is always injected somewhere. In our system, it is injected through the banking system. The Federal Reserve buys some securities, or now mortgage-backed securities. The money enters in the banking system as extra reserves. The banks lower their interest rates to attract more borrowers. The borrowers spend the money beginning investment projects or adding to existing investment projects. They hire workers. They demand resources and construction activities. Those people then receive those sums as revenues or wages. They then spend it, and these ripples of spending and income, ripple out, slowly rising one income, one demand and price, one income, another demand and price, and so on, until it emanates and covers the entire economy, but in the process, pulling up and pushing up prices in general, but in this ragged microeconomic time sequence, uneven way. And in that process, the relative profitabilities of the projects influenced first is higher than projects that will only be influenced and affected later. And that distortion in the structure of relative prices by distorting the expected or realized relative profits from different investment and capital projects influences the allocation of resources, the employment of labor. And finally, when the bubble bursts, it's discovered that this rippling process has drawn resources, workers, into different sectors of the economy doing various things that will now be found unsustainable when the relative price structure now adjusts and rebalances itself to a non-monetary inflationary distorted environment. That is the real phenomena of investment projects that collapse, jobs that are lost, because the monetary expansion has distorted the entire structure of the price signals and the price motives and incentives of the economy to get people to do many wrong things at the wrong time, at the wrong place, under the basis of false conceptions of long-term profitability. This is one of the insights for which Hayek was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics in 1974. What to do? Well, this has led some people to make the case and reach the conclusion that it would be desirable to return to a gold-backed monetary standard that takes the power of directly creating money out of the air away from the hands of government. This was argued, among other economists, by another Austrian economist, in fact, the mentor of Hayek, Ludwig von Mises, who said in an essay, "Why have a monetary system based on gold? Because as conditions are today and for the time that can be foreseen today, the gold standard alone makes the determination of money's purchasing power independent of the ambitions and machinations of governments, dictators, and political parties and pressure groups. The gold standard alone is what the 19th century freedom-loving leaders who championed representative government, civil liberties, and prosperity for all called sound money. The advantage of a monetary system based upon gold is that it depends upon the consumer's demand for gold for both monetary, commercial, and industrial uses, manufacturing uses, and personal consumption uses. Market demand relative to what? To the profitability of prospecting, mining, extracting, refining, and molding and minting gold. That is the normal checks and balances of supply and demand, like any other commodity bought and sold in the market. And out of the hands of the government to just either turn the hand of a printing press, like in the cartoon of Ben Bernanke, or with the click of a mouse, to him, with no cost, to just create money out of thin air on the computer screen. It takes control of the money supply and the power to arbitrarily manipulate it and increase it out of the hands of governments and central banks. This was understood by the free market classical liberal economists of the 19th century. I have here quotes from just two representative ones. First, John Stuart Mill, from his Principles of Political Economy, originally published in 1848, a major textbook for a good part of the second half of the 19th century. No doctrine in political economy rests on more obvious grounds that the mischief of paper money not maintained at the same value with a metallic, that is gold. Great as the evil would be if it depended on accident, gold production, it is still greater when placed at the arbitrary disposal of an individual or a group of or a body of individuals who may have any kind or degree of interest to be served by an artificial fluctuation in fortunes, that is the value of money, and who have at any rate a strong interest in issuing as much inconvertible, that is non-gold-backed paper money, as possible, each issue being its source of profit. Not to add that the issuers have, and in the case of government paper money, always have a direct interest in lowering the value of currency because it is the medium in which its own debts are computed. And often you hear, both officially and unofficially, don't worry about that $17.5 trillion debt. We'll get rid of most of the real burden of it through inflation. Well, that's what John Stuart Mill was warning about in the middle of the 19th century. Such power in whatsoever vested, in whosoever vested, is an intolerable evil. Or as Karl Menger, the founder of the Austrian school, wrote at the time when he was serving as an advisor and on a commission that put the Austro-Hungarian Empire on the gold standard, gold is the money of advanced nations in the modern age. No other money can provide the convenience of a gold currency in our age of rapid and massive commodity exchanges. Silver has become a troublesome tool of trade. Even paper money must yield to gold when it comes to monetary convenience in everyday life. Moreover, under the present conditions, only a gold currency constitutes hard money, that is, non-manipulated money. Neither a banknote and treasury note nor a silver certificate can take the place of gold, especially in moments of crises. Don't worry, Mildred, we're safe. I have a bunch of paper depreciated dollars under the mattress. Don't worry, Mildred, I have gold bullion under the mattress. Which one do you think gives Mildred better confidence in what her husband is doing? Now, all of this, oh my goodness, all of this, a sound monetary system, eliminating the dangers of inflation, all of this will only someday be possible in the wider context of the restoration of a political and economic and social system based upon and securely protecting individual liberty. As I say here, in the long run, our current economic crisis and political dilemma cannot be solved until we restore among our fellow Americans a renewed belief in and desire for individual liberty. Liberty means the right of the individual to live his life as he chooses, guided by his own values and beliefs about what will give him happiness and meaning to his life. Liberty means respect for the equal rights of others to live their lives as they choose and desire. Liberty means that human relationships should be based on peaceful and voluntary consent. Liberty means that in each individual's honestly acquired property and income is respected as rightfully his and may not be plundered and taxed away by others, even when majorities think some minority has not paid some supposed fair share. Liberty means the free competitive interaction of people in the marketplace of goods and ideas, out of which comes the creative and innovative energies of mind and effort that bring about rising standards of living for all. Liberty means a limited government, a government whose purpose is to protect each individual in his freedom and peaceful market and social affairs, and not to be an agent of political oppression or economic favoritism through special privileges and benefits that are given to some at the expense of others in the society. Now, I willingly admit that these are not easy rules and ideals to live by, but they are what America was founded on and which made America great, a land with both freedom and prosperity, and at a time when our monetary system was based upon a commodity such as gold that kept the hand of government off any monetary printing press handle. I'll just conclude with one other quote. And this is from the famous 19th century sociologist, political philosopher, economist, Herbert Spencer, author of a great essay called The Right to Ignore the State, and an excellent collection of essays that is as relevant and timely today as when he wrote them and published them in the 1880s, Man Versus the State. Spencer was an extremely famous sociologist. He's one of the founders of sociology in the 19th century. He has like a three-volume work and then another sort of study intro book about sociology. He wrote about ethics, biology, history, politics, economics, everything. Talk about a Renaissance man. And at the height of his popularity in the late 1870s and 1880s, he was invited to give a lecture tour in the United States. He visited New York, Chicago, a number of other cities. He was huge turnouts to hear the author of these books, this advocate of economic and social and political liberalism, a proponent of laissez-faire, address crowds in America. And he was interviewed by a reporter. And that interview was partly published, as I say here, in the Contemporary Review in January of 1883. And this is what Spencer told the reporter as part of the interview. Free institutions can be maintained only by citizens, each of whom is instant to oppose every illegitimate act. Every assumption of supremacy, every official excess of power, however trivial it may seem. As one of your early statesmen said, the price of liberty is eternal vigilance. But it is far less against foreign aggressions upon national liberty that this vigilance is required than against the insidious growth of domestic interferences. That is, from your own government's interferences with personal liberty. That is against whom you must be eternally vigilant. Your own government. The fact is that free institutions can be properly worked only by men, each of whom is jealous of his own rights, and also sympathetically jealous of the rights of others, who will neither himself aggress on his neighbors in small things or great, nor tolerate aggression on them by others. The republican form of government is the highest form of government. But because of this, it requires the highest type of human nature, a type nowhere present existing. We, the British, have not grown up to it, nor have you, the Americans. What Herbert Spencer was saying there, that America and our British cousins had a long history of believing in, wanting, and attempting to establish the ideals of individual liberty and the limited government institutional foundations for its preservation and endurance and prosperity. But it requires men who understand these principles, value these ideals, are willing to speak up in defense of their own rights and to be sensitive and speak up when others' rights are violated by their own government. Only when men have a true faith and confidence and belief in those values, see their importance, their essentiality to themselves and the society in which they live, will we have attained that level that Spencer talks about, that we'll see that freedom exists and prevails. My generation has done a bad job of it. It's now your generation's turn to try. Thank you very much.
So I think everyone here is pretty much bought into the idea of like capitalism, and this is why we all came to Northwood. But if it's getting people to accept this idea, how do you change that when we live in a place where our public schools are taught what they're told to teach, and you have like pay to participate for sports, and everyone gets a trophy for coming to soccer practice? How do you change it then?
Well, it is not an easy thing to do, and it often becomes a daunting and even depressing task to imagine how do we change the world for better. When Dr. Maciek introduced me, he pointed out that my various positions before I came here included as president of the Foundation for Economic Education. FEE, as it's called. Maybe some of you know about it. They publish a monthly magazine called The Freeman. Maybe you've heard of The Freeman. The founding first president of the Foundation for Economic Education was a man named Leonard Reed. He was an amazing individual who I only had the opportunity to meet once when he was an older gentleman. I went to a FEE seminar, and it was a great week, a summer student seminar at their headquarters then in New York. But I really only remember one talk from that whole week, and it was a talk that Leonard Reed himself gave. There used to be a classroom at the FEE headquarters in New York, and at one point in the lecture, Leonard Reed asked one of the people in the back of the room to turn off the lights in the room, and so now the room is dark, almost pitch black. And he had one of those electric candles with a dimmer switch, and he turned the dimmer switch on just the smallest fraction possible, so there was like this just little glimmer of light. And he said to us, notice how all of our eyes are drawn in this room of darkness to this mere flicker of light. And then he turned the dimmer switch more brightly. And so now there's like this little area around the electric candle. And then he kept turning it on and a little bit more, and he says, notice the brighter it becomes, the more our eyes are drawn to it in this room of darkness. And he continued this until he brought it to its full illumination. And he said, now notice, even this little electric candle lights up practically the entire room, with just a few dark corners around the edges of the walls. He said, that's what each and every one of us can be, lights of liberty. Through a process of self-education, self-improvement, becoming knowledgeable about the ideas of freedom and devising ways how best to articulate, explain, and persuasively present them to others as we find ourselves able to in the circles of people with whom we interact. And hopefully our the reasonableness of our arguments and the methods that we've learned to be persuasive will attract others to see their value, and another person, until the room of the society will be filled with lights of human liberty, and into the corners will be pushed the last vestiges of the blackness of collectivism. He added to this that we all want to change the world. But if we want to change the world, where do we begin? Well, certainly in that part in which we could have potentially the first and most immediate effect. And over whom do we have the greatest ability to bring about a change? With ourselves. Hard enough to change others. My first task is to improve myself. You have to want to learn. You have to want to give time in a day that pulls you in many directions. There's many opportunity costs of your time. But to see the value and importance to at least begin to learn about these ideas of political, social, economic liberty, to understand their logic and a bit of their history. Follow the news and think about what you're reading in the context of the principles that you're learning and teaching yourself if there's no one else to learn them from, and how to apply them. And then with friends, family member, co-workers, the guy on the park bench when a conversation starts up, learn to persuasively present them. And hopefully you will influence people. Now, I have to do one other thing, because this is an important question. I know you can easily become despondent. There was an advocate of liberty named Albert J. Nock in the 1930s and 1940s. His most famous book is The Man Versus the State. It was published in 1935. But he wrote this little essay called Isaiah's Job. It's taken from the Bible. And the nutshell of the story is God calls upon Isaiah to go preach among the people because they have fallen into sinful ways, and he's supposed to persuade them to come back to God's righteousness. And Isaiah, being, you know, a good guy, listens to God, and he goes out, you know, give up your sinful ways, you know, become righteous, come back to the bosom of God. The problem is he keeps doing this, and all he sees is people sinning, debauchery, gambling, you know, all that bad stuff. And he becomes despondent, he becomes depressed, he becomes frustrated. Why has God sent me on this task? When it seems that I'm speaking into the air, nobody listens. And so God then talks to Isaiah one more time. And he said, you don't know what effect your words have, how it influences people's minds, thoughts, and actions after you have left them. That's my task. I know what's in other people's minds and in their hearts and souls. You don't. Your task is just to preach righteousness because you know it to be right. Now, what Nock was saying here is that you can never know how your ideas can influence another in espousing the causes of liberty and freedom. All you can do is talk to others. Some people, perhaps many people, just find it uninteresting, irrelevant, or unpersuasive. Talking to the wall sometimes. But you never know who you're going to influence. That some thought stays in somebody's mind because of something you said and rattles around in their brain. And a week later, a month later, 2 years later, suddenly clicks. And that person has been influenced in a way that you'll never know about. Now, again, to emphasize this, when I was in graduate school in New York, I was a poor student. I needed money. I was doing some part-time teaching at Rutgers. But I was living in New York City, and I had to take the subway over to New Jersey, teach my evening class, then come back to New York in the subway under the Hudson River. But then I had to take the New York subway from Manhattan to that part of New York, Queens, where I was actually living. And you had to change trains in lower Manhattan from the train coming from New Jersey to the New York City subway system. And above this train station that I normally made the shift at, there was a grocery store, a deli. And I would often, you know, since I had to change trains and pay for the subway anyway, I would go up and, get some things if I needed to do some shopping. So this is an absolutely true story. I'm online in this deli above the subway station in lower New York, and I'm at the checkout counter, and this woman is behind me. I don't know who she is. I've never seen her. I'm not even paying attention to her. She says, aren't you Richard Ebeling? Yes. You teach at Rutgers, don't you? Yeah. You've ruined my marriage. Help. It turns out that this woman's husband was taking classes at Rutgers University and taking a class with me. She must have been on campus with him. I must have been walking around. He must have pointed me out to her. You've ruined my marriage. Excuse me? My husband took you for a class, and all he does now is come home from work at night, turn on the evening news, and complain the entire night about government. You have ruined my marriage. You can't know. Now, that's a weird example. I know, it's like, what? It's almost unbelievable. You never know how you're going to influence someone. I'm a teacher. I'm interacting with students, it seems like my entire life. There are students who sit in the front row and talk. There are students who sit in the front row and don't talk but seem to be taking notes or playing now with their text messaging or whatever they're doing. And then there's some student who's sitting in the back who just never says a word, never visits me during, office hours. Maybe not be like the A-plus student, maybe the B student. But that might be the student that I say something, or any other professor says something in their class that ends up having an impact on their life. Like this person, who I didn't even know who he was, who has now ruined his wife's, I've ruined the guy's wife's life because he now is obsessed with politics and government. You never know how you're going to influence people. All you can do is be responsible for your own actions and doing what you know to be true based upon what you believe to be right. If each and every one of us does this, trends will change. Minds and hearts will be shifted, and we can have a freedom of liberty. What we can be sure of is that these ideas at the end of the day fail. Every form of collectivism that has been tried has failed. Communism, socialism, fascism, Nazism, welfare statism is bankrupting us and reaching its own end. Nobody even really believes in this stuff anymore. It's like a machine moving by its own, you know, inertia, because nothing has stopped it yet, but it's heading for the cliff. We can change these things, but it requires each of us to have the interest, the integrity, the willingness, and the courage to hold views that, to be honest, are often unpopular and arouse scorn and ridicule. But like Isaiah, I don't know how other people hear what I have to say. All I can do is try to be true to what I think is right, and that is what each and every one of us can only do if we're going to be true to ourselves. Thank you very much.
Okay, we can take questions for either Dr. Nash or Dr. Ebling. Does anybody have, I know we didn't have a chance really to talk to Dr. Nash after his presentation. Does anybody have any questions for Dr. Nash?
You were that persuasive, Tim. You see, that's what I was just talking about. You have changed all these minds. There's no questions left. Oh, no. You know what the world hates, Tim?
Question here.
Let's put it this way. I needed the money. Like most students, you know, I got by with part-time jobs, some savings, a bit of a scholarship stipend, and so I was working for money. That's to pay some bills. I'll be watching you, Tim. Any other questions for either Dr. Nash or myself? Yeah.
This is kind of off topic, but you had a picture of Hayek. By any chance, are you related to him?
No.
Okay.
Only intellectually. I view him as an intellectual father. I can say, if I can say so, I had the honor and the privilege to spend a good part of 2 summers in his company. And it was one of the most intellectually and personally meaningful and rewarding experiences I ever had, because he truly was a wonderful and delightful human being, besides being a great mind. But I appreciate the suggestion that I somehow look like him. For me, I take that as a compliment, okay? So I don't know how you meant it, but I take it as a compliment. Any other questions, comments?
I have one.
Yeah.
So if you ask someone what they think about, if you ask, like, what do you think about the deficit, everyone and their dog has an opinion about it. But it doesn't seem many people know that this is even an issue, you know, with our monetary policy.
Right.
If we've got, like, I know I just read that China has 9 trade agreements with other countries to cut the dollar out. I know the IMF proposed a plan to remove the dollar as a reserve currency and do a basket currency. If everyone in the world seems to know that our currency is getting toxic, why don't we? I don't.
Because there's no substitute for the dollar right now, you see.
Yeah.
It has been the international reserve currency for both governments and private commercial transactions virtually since the end of the Second World War. Everybody realizes that if everyone jumps ship at the same time because of the concern about how stable and confident the dollar will be given the debt, possible inflation, it would just fall like a stone. But then everybody who's holding dollar-denominated assets, accounts, and everything would suddenly see that fall relative to other currencies. So it's a very precarious situation. It's just based upon confidence. Let me say something that I don't remember if Dr. Nash in his presentation brought out, but I think is, the $17.5 trillion, that's not everything we owe. You know, Dr. Nash and Mr. Tanner talked about Obamacare, these health care issues. The fact is there is another debt that hangs over your heads, and that is what are called the unfunded liabilities. That is under current legislation and eligibility, how much is the federal government committed to pay to people in years and decades to come for Social Security and Medicare? There are Social Security and Medicare trust funds. These are obviously government trust funds. But they have CPAs and accountants, you know, and demographic experts, and they do an actuarial horizon of 75 years. In other words, given over the next three quarters of a century, which for us now is almost to the end of this century, given aging, the aging population, and when people are likely to retire, and on average how many years they've worked, and therefore how, you know, the minimum Social Security that this person and that person will be able to make a claim for, you know, out of the government, an aging population, and the likely medical expenses given eligibility and medical costs looking, you know, over the decades. They estimate that what the government will owe for the next 75 years based upon, you know, current legislation, eligibility, and demographic, you know, forecasting and trend estimates, the federal government will have to pay out somewhere between $100 trillion and $125 trillion. And that's not counting the 17.5. Where the hell is that money coming from? Now, as our speaker last night pointed out, and I think he pointed out, somehow the government will end up having to, quote, reform Social Security, which in my opinion does not mean real reform. What it will mean is they'll tweak the system. They'll raise the retirement age. They'll modify, you know, the amounts that you'll be able to be eligible to receive Social Security in terms of the cost of living adjustment methods, and so on and so forth. And they'll raise Social Security contributions, that is, deductions out of your paycheck under that heading, in terms of, you know, withdrawals from your pay before you receive your take-home checks. But the fact is, that will not be sufficient to deal with this. There's going to be more money that the government has to pay out than it will be taking in. It already is that case. And the only source of revenue that the government has to cover these obligations of this over $100 trillion looking to the decades ahead is future taxes or future borrowing, which itself means future taxes further down the road. And that is the albatross that is hanging over each and every one of yours next. Because Dr. Nash, myself, Doug Bando, tomorrow's 8:30 speaker, you know, we're getting up there, young whippersnappers. You know, we won't see the end of the 21st century. With modern medicine, many of you might. Certainly your children will, and live beyond into the 22nd century. So these demographic and quote entitlement burdens are the ones you and your children are going to face. That's what previous generations and the current generations and the corruption of past and present politicians have left as your legacy from them.
Do you think that the Bitcoin could be the new currency?
Do I think what now? I'm sorry?
Do you believe that the Bitcoin could turn into like the new gold standard?
The question is, will Bitcoin turn into a potential new currency? Well, the federal government has already said that it's not a currency for tax purposes. It's an asset upon which you will owe taxes. I believe that people should be able to use the medium of exchange that they find most advantageous and beneficial for their own planning and in their exchanges and transactions with others. I don't think government should have a monopoly over this, dictate it, or prevent anybody from trying, experimenting, and using if they find it profitable to do so and others are willing to take it and use it with them in exchange. The problem, I'm not saying this as someone, I believe in choice in currency. I would like to see a return to non-governmental controlled money, whatever it were to be called and the form it should take. But through the eyes of an historian, unless the U.S. economy fell into a significant and even severe price inflation, I think it would take a very long time with a lot of uncertainty as to whether Americans would, of their own choice, shift into a new medium of exchange and out of the dollar. It's already institutionally there. People are used to it. There's a certain cultural and institutional inertia. It's mandatory to pay your taxes in dollars, so you can't get out of dollars completely because of our tax burdens. So it may exist if it's allowed to develop, and if it be found and if it's found to be stable, certain, and not open to fraudulent manipulations as seem to have recently occurred, it could emerge as a secondary parallel currency that may have a greater or smaller relevancy and place in monetary and financial transactions. But to be honest, from the experience of history, a currency has to reach either high or even hyperinflation and have so much uncertainty, unpredictability, and volatility that people just for day-to-day transactions find it out of necessity to shift into an alternative money of choice. Historically, a paper money has fallen into a hyperinflation. People don't trust their currency is going to get any better. They start using dollars or British pounds because, in comparison, those have seemed more stable than their own erratic paper currency. Or they've shifted into gold or other metallic substitutes. But you need to shake up the inertia and the institutional habits and customs of the system to really break away from an existing medium of exchange. It doesn't happen easily or quickly. Any other? You had your student Timmy, you had your hand up?
Dr. Ebling, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we are going to serve dinner again. It's starting at 6 o'clock. It's prime rib tonight, and our presentation will start after dinner, 7 o'clock. See you tonight.